friends. Today we have Sharanya Vanka with us, who is one of our course enrolled students for the Applied AI course. And she has successfully made a transition to a data scientist role at Value Labs very recently. I believe you just recently joined Value Labs, right?
Correct. Today is my second day.
Oh, cool, cool. And prior to this, she has about 4 years of work experience in IT in companies like Accenture and Uber. So thank you, Sharanya, for taking the time to share your learning experiences and also your interview experiences.
Thanks a lot, sir. Pleasure is mine.
So could you walk us through your interview experiences? Because that's what students want to understand. Correct. So that they can also get a sense of what to learn, what to focus on, and things like that.
Correct. So first of all, this was my first interview for a data scientist role. So I was actually surprised looking at the interview process, and it could be different for different companies again. But my interview process, I had 3 interviews. And when I started off the course, in one of your videos, as you mentioned, that depth comes later, but breadth first. So, but still, I understood that, but I was always like, I have to complete all the algorithms. I need to know the crux of each algorithm. And even though it's a modification of a small algorithm also that we use, I tried to focus more on knowing each and everything. But much to my surprise, in the actual interview, they were quite focused on the crux of, like, if you take a business problem, what will be on your platter? Also that I have worked for a startup earlier before getting this role. I have worked for a startup for 6 months. So in that startup, I have done a couple of projects, especially mostly on NLP. So my first 15 minutes, like the first half of my interview, majorly focused on the projects that I have done. Also, not just like explaining the business objective, but also they were quite going deep into, like, if I used logistic regression for a problem, they tried to go into like logistic regression optimization equation, but that's it. Like, they didn't go deep down, but they were like, what if you use this approach and why didn't you use this approach? So they were focusing more on the approach rather than knowing, for example, if there are 10 algorithms that they asked you for, even if you know 5 of it, they were still fine. If I'm telling the 5 perfectly, like, in which situation will I use this algorithm? And why wouldn't you use another? For example, why wouldn't you use a tree-based algorithm in a particular situation? So I think they were more focused on that. Like, I would also consider
it more focused on breadth and your understanding of applicative knowledge.
Correct.
But you also mentioned that for logistic regression, they were going into the optimization problem. So they expect some math, but not too much.
Correct. Because in my resume also, my plus is maths, because I've been very good in mathematics. And that was one of the primary reasons that I took up this course. So I was good with maths. That's why they just wanted to test more on mathematics side. But that was it. Like, hardly, I was asked like 30 seconds about like the optimization equation, not much into it. But again, they try to focus more on the statistics part. Like, for example, if you're taking a hypothesis testing, you could try to explain various examples and how would you go about it. But they were like, they asked a very simple question with which they can understand whether I know about it or no. Like, they asked, how would you get the p-value? So that was like one question. It's a deal breaker, whether you know it or not. So I still felt that the first round was more on the basics of machine learning. And again, yeah, they did touch deep learning as such, because also that I was not working. I didn't have a working experience on deep learning. But they tried to ask almost like also if, and there were a few questions that I would be knowing only if I worked. Like, for example, feature scaling. Like, why would you need it in the first place? And when would you normalize or when would you standardize?
So surely there will be some questions wherein if you have actually solved a real world case study, either in the course or at your work, only then you'll be able to connect for sure.
Correct. And also, so the assignments, of course, help. But I coming from a non-coding background, in the beginning, I faced a lot of problems.
Like, so you came from a completely non-coding background, right? I think that's important to mention. Yes.
Correct. So, of course, I've done my BTech in electronics and computers, but there was only like a 1 year where I could learn about computers that had CS involved. So, coming from a non-coding background, it was tough for me, but initially I only knew SQL. So post SQL, I wanted to do something in data analysis part or something in business analysis. And that's how I got to know about this course.
As far as the interview experiences, you told about the first interview. What about the second and third interviews? What was the focus areas there?
Correct. So the second interview was again on my projects again, because there were different people interviewing. But this time they asked more on deep learning. Again, on deep learning, they wanted to know why deep learning came in the first place. Like, why couldn't we just go on with machine learning? And in which cases would you go for deep learning? And which case would you again stick back to the classing ML methods? And then came RNN, CNN, and in deep learning also, there were a few concepts that I didn't know of. And I was very, I was frank with that I didn't know of these concepts. But in the concepts that I knew, for example, in that also, they were asking the basic, for example, dropout. Why did dropout come in the first place? And and one of the main things that you told in the notes also that in the course also that dropout rate, like what will happen in the train time and test time? So I think that was one of the most important questions. Usually while going through the course, that's just another concept that you write on the notes. But that was asked. So nothing beyond the notes came, of course. But the second round focused more on deep learning. And again, more on my projects. And like in the first round, they focused on two of my projects. And the other one, they focused on the third round.
So what about the third round? Was it mostly a manager HR round or was it also technical?
It was more a managerial round. Like they told me the nature of work and they tried to know how much data analysis do I know in that. And also I'd like to add here that in the second round, they also asked me on pandas and NumPy operations. Like loading a CSV file, we know that because we have it. You can use it. It's just a single line of code. But they asked me, they tried to know if there's any other way to do it. So they were asking those basic operations. They didn't ask something that I need to remember, or they didn't ask me anything that I can, which is just a Google search away.
Okay. So they were looking at your understanding on why you use something or how something came into existence or how something works, not something more like memory based. Do you know this function in NumPy or pandas?
No. That's exactly why I was surprised, because I was trying to memorize each
thing. No. So I think memorizing functions is useless. Even I forget so many of them. Like in some of my live sessions, I Google search. I open a browser window and say, hey guys, I don't remember. Let's Google search. It's just a Google search.
I learned that from your live sessions, but sometimes that fear is always there. Right? As in they can also think that you work so much. So if you don't even know the basic function of NumPy at the top, that was the fear. But again, that was like, that came on my face that no, it's not, that's not how it works.
Very good. Very, very nice. So in terms of coding, did you have any coding round in your interviews?
No. I didn't have any coding rounds.
Okay. Got it. So how did you now, given this experience and also given that you've been with Applied AI course for a while, what was your learning experience? How did you manage your work and learning from Applied AI course? How did you balance all that? Because the course is non-trivial, obviously. So how did you balance all of it? What was your learning strategy? How were you putting in effort and things like that?
Correct. So the first video that I saw in trial, the free videos, the first one you said was consistency. And then I realized that it's not very easy. So that's when time management, as you said, is very important for this course. Sometimes you get laid back, like there's a whole 1 year to complete it. So you can, you know, there's very little, that's how you think about it. But then slowly, what I tried to do is I kept small targets. Like if you explain pandas and NumPy, say in like half day, I tried to work on it for 1 week, because I don't come from a coding background. I tried to give more time to the basic things. Also, I had a guide who was mentoring me with, he also kept telling that, you know, these basic operations are as important and they're overlooked. So I tried to look at those basic stuff and I started working on those first. And then slowly.
And I'm sure you might have had to spend more time in the first module because you come from a non-programming background.
Correct. It took me time, but as you said, the learn-to-learn approach that I started doing the small examples on Python and I started brushing up my own Python skills, because again, the assignments part was a bit scary because I didn't know it. But slowly, I tried to pick myself up and that's about it. I completed the machine learning part and especially the case studies. I think case studies in this course especially will give you like enough confidence as if as if it were like in a situation where a business problem is there, and you literally know like half of the business problems on your platter already. So the case studies helped a lot. And I think post case studies only, I started applying for roles.
Okay, got it.
And that's how I landed the internship at a startup. And then I worked for the startup. And then
worked in the startup for about 6 months and then transitioned to a full-time data scientist role.
Correct.
This is something that we recommend a lot of students, especially who come from non-programming background, that it's always good to intern in a startup, get that 6 months to 9 months to 12 months experience, and then jump to a larger company or convert as a full-time role in that startup itself. That's a much more natural path for people coming from non-programming backgrounds or people who have a career break.
Yes, because I initially got a bit demotivated looking at your success stories, which is like, I know it is there for motivating people, but I got a bit demotivated saying people are just going on with the assignments and they're saying they've watched all the videos and they're done with the course. And then I started to understand that it's not same for everybody. Yes. So then I started to tackle a bit, like take a small data set and work on it, like how to even load a data frame and then go about the basic operations on it. That will give you a bit confidence that, okay, this is not that hard. You can go forward.
Yes, that's very valid. And that's the purpose of the assignments also, to get started small, start with small Python programs, keep gradually increasing the complexity of problems you solve.
Correct.
Cool. So roughly, on an average, how much effort were you putting in on a weekly basis on this course and all the practice associated with it?
Correct. So roughly, I would, because I was working, I'd take like two full days in the weekend. Like okay. Saturday and Sunday. But I would look at it by module wise. Like I'd write down my timetable and I'd say that I'll complete this module in a particular time frame, and I would do it. Sometimes it will go 1 week here and there. But on an average, I would give, say, 25 to 30 hours per week.
Okay, got it. And probably you took slightly more time because you come from completely non-programming background and you had to pick up some of these details.
Correct.
Cool. So any suggestions you have for students very similar to you with about 4 years of non-coding experience in IT who wants to transition to data science careers based on your own experiences? Again, there is no one winning strategy. There is no one winning solution. Everybody has a different story. So we thought we'll hear your suggestions based on your own experiences.
Correct. So as you said, there's no one winning strategy. So you can look at people's stories and listen to their strategies, like how they worked on it. But I'd say the most important one is consistency. Like everybody says it, but it's very hard to follow also, especially if you're working.
Hard work is hard.
Yeah. And so the results will be sweet.
Yes.
But I think consistency, like even if you take a break for 1 week and you have a low week and you're not able to, you're stuck at a problem, give it some time and just move forward. That's it. Don't just get stuck saying that, see, I'm not good at coding, or I'm not able to do an assignment, or I'm not understanding this topic. Especially if you don't understand a topic, you can just rewatch the video and you'll definitely understand, considering you're explaining it. Your explanation is really good and very clear. Like even a layman or a fifth class student can understand it. But I'd say one suggestion is, don't get scared that you can't do this transition. Of course, everybody will say that it is very hard and you can't do it. You need a lot of experience, but you never know. There will be roles which will not require that much experience. You just don't, you know, you're not exactly knowing the market and you're getting scared. So get to know the market and also, like, especially with the course, consistency and persistent hard work. And time management, definitely. Like time management helps a lot. Like even if you're not doing, if you take a break of 1 month or you're working on something at your professional space, like at your work, I think just bouncing back and completing and again pacing up yourself is what helps a lot. And first complete the course content, because nothing beyond the course content will be asked in the interviews. And you don't need to memorize something at the top of your head and get tensed about it. You have to know the crux of why you're using something in a particular situation.
More foundational understanding.
Correct.
Cool. Thank you, Sharanya, for taking the time and sharing your own learning experiences and interview experiences. I'm sure they will help a lot of non-coding background professionals think of and not be fearful of a transition to a data science role. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks to you. You have helped all of us, especially me. because your explanation has helped me write down a very good elaborate notes, and I only studied that before any interview. So I'm very glad and thankful to you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Sharanya.
Thanks, sir.